Class today, and the third graders are learning Bible basics. They receive a Bible. Thank you for the church women for that gift. And we just are learning some Bible basics. So it was wonderful to be able to meet, and their celebration is next week. Confirmation registration is open. We begin confirmation on Wednesday, October 7th, but please see your Friday newsletter for a registration link and a lot more information. Also, in-person and virtual Sunday school begins on October 4th, and that too, the registration link is in our Friday newsletter. Please consider whether God is calling you to help with our live streaming ministry. We are so grateful to Cole Anderson, who has been here every Sunday for the last 6 months. And that is... He is willing to train people to learn how to do this, and he has assured us that it's not that complicated, but we actually need somebody to sit here by this tablet. So if you are interested in this ministry, or we also have back where Dave Anderson is, we need somebody to be advancing PowerPoint slides. And that's very important to us because we use this on-screen bulletin every Sunday. So if you are interested in one of these two positions, please talk to Maggie Sogsted. Can you raise your hand, Maggie? Or myself. And we will get you trained and get you plugged in. So thank you for that. If you haven't already, please go back and pick up an individual communion cup for communion later. They are on the offering stands. Melody has already had, Melody, our office manager, has already had a few phone calls for parents looking for winter gear for their children. So if you are so willing to either purchase new or if you have gently used winter coats, snow pants, boots, hats, mitts, please bring those to either the church office or that other large entry area there, and you'll see on the coat racks there all the coats that are hanging there. Thank you for your generosity on that. We will celebrate a baptism after this service, and so we celebrate with the Decker family, and that will be a private baptism at 11:30. Thank you to those of you that have reached out. I put on Facebook a family that was in need, that needed clothes. Just everything from head to toe for these children. And many of you responded very quickly, so thank you for that. I've been asked to announce that there's two people in the room, at least, that have a special birthday. And so congratulations to Dick Gores and his great-grandson, little Aiden. So one of them is 2 and one is 80. I'll let you decide. Patty Gearing has done a phenomenal job as our Sunday school coordinator, but because of the demands of her other job, she has needed to resign her position as Sunday school coordinator. We are so grateful for all that she has given Trinity for the last few years. If you know somebody who is interested in this position, it is 10 hours a week, and again, coordinating our Sunday school program. In our Friday newsletter was the job description, and if anybody is interested, please send a resume to me. Have you gotten the hint that there's so much in our Friday newsletter? So please pay attention to that, whether that comes to you through email or snail mail, because a lot of information is in there. I want to thank Shannon Dantzler this morning for her beautiful music. Thank you to Gail and the band this morning. It's so nice to have you all back. So that is wonderful. Today in scripture, we're going to hear a parable about generosity. Those are all the announcements I have, so with joy, we begin worship.
Will the congregation please rise? Come to us with your steadfast love, O God. Praise to the blessed and holy Trinity, one God. Let us enter worship with thanksgiving and praise. Gather in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful Lord, you show us how to live as your servants, yet we ask as though your teaching applies to everyone else but us. We pass judgment on others, devalue ourselves, and disrespect creation. Show us the way back to the path that leads to life, and help us repair the damage we have caused to our relationships, ourselves, and this earth, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Thank God we are forgiven, and all things are being made new through Christ. Your grace is enough to cover us and make us whole again to live and serve another day. Let us rejoice that our God is full of mercy, and we are gathered to worship and scattered to serve. Amen. We'll sing together.
Upon the cross forsaken. Let us pray. Holy Lord, you are merciful, just, and gracious. Make us grateful recipients of your generosity and joyful dispensers of the same lavish benefits to those who depend on us. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from Jonah 3:10 through 4:11. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "Is it better for me to die than to live?" But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who did not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" Please join me responsively in Psalm 145. "I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever." Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The second reading is from Philippians 1, 21 through 30. "For to me, living in Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that, whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege, not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have." Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Carla. I invite you to please stand for the reading of the gospel. It comes from the 20th chapter of the book of Matthew. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into the vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. And when he went out again, about noon and about 3, he did the same thing. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" And they said to him, "Because no one has hired us." And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I gave to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And you may be seated. Grace, peace, and mercy to you on this day from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. So what is fair? I mean, the world tells us that you get what you deserve. Or it's about keeping score and then making someone pay. Or we might hear, those who are righteous will be blessed and sinners will be cursed. Well, these statements are very law-based, and there is little room in there for grace. Well, picture this scene. There's a large group of men who have gathered in the town square at daybreak, and they're waiting to be chosen for a day of working in the vineyards. These are day laborers. They have no regular job, but they seek employment on a daily basis. They are kind of the lowest rung of the economic ladder, and they live a day-to-day type of life. Now, if employed, they will make a day's wage, which will feed their families. These are people who know food insecurity, and so they wait, and they hope. And this is not a situation that is limited just to first century. Well, soon a wealthy landowner comes to town, and it's 6 a.m., and he chooses many of those workers, and he enters into a contract with them, agreeing to pay them a full day's wage. Perfect, think the men. And they scramble to his vineyard, and they begin to work. Well, at 9 o'clock, the landowner returns to town and hires more men, because the work is plentiful. And he tells them, "I will pay you whatever is right." In other words, I'll make it good for you. Well, he returns at noon, and he returns at 3 with the same offer to those that are waiting there for employment. But when he comes to town at 5 o'clock, an hour before quitting time, and he sees the remnant of men sitting around, he asks them, "Why haven't you been working today?" And they respond, "Nobody hired us." So he says, "Okay, go join the others in my vineyard." So far, this seems like the landowner has given these men many opportunities to work. And they all know that at the end of the day, that they are going to go home with at least a little money for food. Well, at the end of the day, the men gather to collect their wages. And as the landowner instructs the manager calls the 5 o'clockers up first. to come get paid. And can you imagine their surprise when they are handed a full day's wage? I mean, they are just like incredulous. They are shocked. And word is trickling back down the line as the 9 o'clockers come up, and the people at noon, and the 3 o'clockers, and they all get a full day's wage. So at this point, the 6 o'clockers are probably calculating what their wage will be. I mean, if the 5 o'clockers got a full day's wage, what will theirs be? And it's a reasonable expectation, don't you think? That if people who had worked only an hour received this amount of money, those who had worked all day long might receive more. But when the 6 o'clockers got up to the manager, they received a full day's wage. And they were furious. "That's not fair," they cried. Have you ever been one of the 6 o'clock workers? Someone got the same as you, even though you worked much harder and longer than they did. But the thing about this parable is that the 6 o'clockers didn't get any less, because that wouldn't be fair, but they got exactly what had been agreed upon at the beginning of the day. They got a full day's wage. They didn't get the short end of the stick, although it felt like it to them. And that's why they got angry. And we might too. And I love this language, because the landowner turns, or the manager turns to one of them and says, "Friend." No, it was the landowner. Turns to them and says, "Friend." He calls them friend. Speaking to them on equal terms, not speaking down to them. And he said, "I'm doing no wrong. I'm paying you exactly what we agreed upon. So suck it up, buttercup." That's kind of a loose translation, but you know. But he does say, "If I pay somebody more, what is it to you? Are you envious of my generosity?" And some of them probably thought, "Ooh, you know what? You're right." As much as we know he's right, it still bugs us a little bit. That's why this parable can sometimes be hard. Because all of our life experiences, even perhaps our parents, told us about the importance of hard work. And so everything we know about life tells us that this isn't quite fair. I mean, the 5 o'clockers got a full day's wage. The 6 a.m. people deserved at least a little bit more, right? I mean, isn't this parable all about the deserving? Well, at the beginning of my sermon, I said that the world sometimes tells us that we get what we deserve. Well, take heed and be a little careful when we say this or believe this. Because if we actually got what we deserved through the kingdom of God lenses, if we were rewarded for our righteousness, or if we were rewarded by our level of sin, well, then all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All have sinned. That is everybody in this room. That is everybody in our virtual congregation. That is everybody who ever walked this earth. I mean, can anyone stand up and declare that they are sinless? No. So if we get what we deserve, Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. How do you like those kind of wages? There's a great meme that says that grace is when God gives us what we don't deserve, and mercy is when God doesn't give us what we do deserve. and the fairness, God steps in with his only son, Jesus, and sends him to the earth. Jesus, fully human, fully divine, and he suffered and he died for us. And he did not deserve that. We did. And he rose from the grave to conquer death so that we wouldn't get what we deserved. Now, the world tells us that it isn't fair. And Jesus tells this parable about the kingdom of God, about what God wants the world to be like. He wants a world where everyone is treated the same, despite their contribution to society, despite their accomplishments. A world where everyone is treated with respect and dignity. This parable is not about fairness. It is not about labor relations, but it is totally about the gift of grace, that amazing grace. And why is it that sometimes it is hard for us to accept this unconditional grace, to accept this free gift? Because we see God's generosity sometimes and we don't like it. Sometimes we resist it for ourselves and for others. Carla read from the Old Testament this story about Jonah. God sends Jonah to Nineveh, a place of many sinners. And Jonah goes this way, says, "Why would you send me to Nineveh? I'm not going to go there." But God wants to extend his love and generosity and grace to the people of Nineveh. And I love it because that's when Jonah said, "Oh, I just knew it. I just knew it that you would be gracious and merciful and slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love." Jonah is mad that God is offering the people of Nineveh grace. There's a story about a college student who attended a Christian college, and one of her professors wanted to teach the students what grace looked like. Now, the professor didn't prep the students for what he was going to do. He just wanted to play out naturally to see how it would go. So the students entered the classroom to take an exam that they'd been studying for quite a while. They all knew that this was going to be a tough one. The professor handed out the test and asked that the students kind of read through the test before they began. He wished them all luck, and he sat down. Now, as the students looked over the test, they came to the last question that read, "You can try to get an A on this test, or you could just put your name on it and hand it in and automatically receive an A." Students started looking around the classroom, incredulous, shocked, wondering if this was some kind of hidden test, what was going on. And they slowly signed their name on the test and began walking forward to place their test on the professor's desk. But one student, whose mother was a teacher, had studied hard for this test and was upset that someone could just sign their name on it and automatically get an A. So she decided that she was going to take that test on the principle of it, and she would get the A because she deserved it. She could not accept this grace that was being offered from the professor. It just wasn't fair. Well, I have learned a lot about God's grace since that college day. I've learned that God's grace is offered whether I ace a test or I just sign my name. God's grace is not dependent on my actions. This parable invites us into a conversation about what is fair. It invites us into relationships with each other so that we can learn to accept God's grace for all people. And we need to be willing to hear each other's stories. I mean, really listen Because we all have varied life experiences that shape us and our understanding of the world. And Jesus is inviting us into other people's stories. So where have you seen grace extended? To yourself? To others? And we know that grace and generosity can't be measured. The God who was and is to come offers you scandalous grace, undeserved grace. And you know what? It isn't fair, because Jesus had to die for it. So the takeaway from this parable is that God is so generous with his love and his grace that it just seems totally out of the norm. In fact, it doesn't seem fair. But he offers it to us, not because we're so great and deserve it, but in fact, just the opposite, because we aren't so great and we don't deserve it. And then our response to this generosity can be that we can extend it to others. Let it be an extension of the welcome and the abundance that we have received from God. And by extending it to others, maybe, just maybe, they might see God's goodness through us. So no matter how much we identify with the 6 a.m.ers, those 6 o'clockers, those who worked all day, in the end, we realize that we are the 5 o'clockers. Those who had no good reason to expect an abundant, undeserving generosity. And this is the God we discover through his son Jesus, the God who looks at us in love, overlooking all those places where we fall short, and still chooses us, and then bestows on us this unmerited grace and mercy and generosity. So, my friends, just sign your name and hand in the paper. All is taken care of by our Creator and our Redeemer. Amen.
Worthy is
congregation please rise as we speak together words of faith in the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Holy God, loving Savior, we give you thanks that you come to us, we who are unworthy of the goodness that you provide. Shape us, mold us, open our eyes and hearts to trust your goodness meant for us and for the whole world, so that we can walk and live in that way. Lord, in your mercy. God of miracles, you soften, harden hearts, and you create new beginnings. You molded the earth, and you shaped it, and you continue to work now. We pray for this world in places where drought reigns and places where flood reigns. In the midst of fire and calamity, we pray for your presence, for those who have faced destruction and fear. We pray for your stewardship to be among us, that you would shape us to be good stewards of this earth. Lord, in your mercy. O God, you are the one who can do all that we need. We pray now for all those who are facing infirmity, that you may be a healer. We lift up before you today, especially Joanne Olson, Ron Syme, Jean Jellin, Fred Tiedemann, Doug Medetsky, Linda Goulet, Kevin Roth, Tara Johannesson's brother-in-law, Jesse, Sue Meyer, Joanne Breitbach. We pray for all those in active military service, especially for Troy Smith and Ellie Cordy. Lord, in your mercy. Whenever we are in doubt, we pray for faith. Surround us especially with faith in times of grief. For all those who walk through a period of mourning, hold them close now. Lord, in your mercy. We place into your hands these things for which we pray. Your promises are certain and your mercy sure. For Jesus' sake, amen. I invite you to be seated as we hear our offertory. Today we will be taking part in Holy Communion, and if you haven't used these cups yet, a little explanation of how we'll do this is this cup has grape juice in it, and underneath the cellophane is a small wafer of bread. And so what we'll do is we'll have the words of institution in the Lord's Prayer as we normally would, and at that point I'll ask you to remove the foil. And we'll drink the wine or drink the grape juice first, just because it's a little easier to get to. But we'll all open this, and then when all are ready, I'll invite you to drink together. And then once all have drank from the cup, we'll remove the cellophane, and you'll find the small piece of bread. And then when we're all ready, we'll have the bread together. I invite you to stand for the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. I invite you to remove the foil. The blood of Christ shed for you. And then the bread. Body of Christ given for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Receive the blessing. May our generous God bless you and keep you and give you peace today and always. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing our closing song.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set. been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
God is good, and all the time. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Ransom.